Here are the top 5 underrated but awesome subclasses in D&D. Way of the Long Death Monk. Okay, so the whole idea of the Long Death Monk is to extract benefits from killing people. Starting at level 3, when you reduce a creature to 0 hit points, you gain temporary hit points equal to your monk level plus your wisdom modifier. That's a lot of temporary hit points. This is amazing for plowing through hordes of weaker enemies, tanking damage and then regenerating with every kobold you murder. Then, at 6th level, you get the Hour of Reaping ability, letting you use an action to terrorize everybody nearby. Any creature within 30 feet of you needs to make a wisdom save or be frightened of you until the end of your next turn. A 30-foot radius sphere effect is big. Sure, it costs your entire action, but usually they charge a key point for doing things like this as a monk. Not this time, though. Being spooky is apparently free. Frightened enemies have disadvantage on all attack rolls and ability checks, making this an amazing combo move to support any allies who attempt to grapple. But the real fire in the Way of the Long D is their level 11 ability, Mastery of Death. Anytime you are reduced to 0 hit points, you can spend just 1 key point, no action required, to fall to 1 hit point instead. That is insane! You are now the tankiest class in the business. You can strap yourself up with explosives, go and give the bad guy a bear hug, and walk away after the blast with 1 hit point. You have 11 key points at this level, all of which recharge on a short rest. When it comes to damage, you just ain't gonna die. Final ability is the level 17 Touch of Long Death. Spend 1 to 10 key points to deal 2d10 necrotic damage for each key point you've spent to any creature you touch, or half as much on a successful con save. Sure, it's not quite as OP as the Open Hand Monk's Quivering Palm, but it's still incredibly strong. Plus, it's hilarious to deal 200 necrotic damage to someone just by shaking their hand. If you're looking for a monk that hits hard and is nearly impossible to kill, this is an amazing choice. Light Domain Cleric. What's the fastest way to set a lion on fire? You simply light domain. Okay, yes, that was a terrible joke, but it does raise an important point. Light Domain Clerics are the only cleric subclass that get Fireball. It's just added to your spell list. In fact, Light Domain Clerics get a bunch of great spells, like Scorching Ray and Flaming Sphere, to let them keep up with wizards in terms of damage output. You also get Wall of Fire for a great control spell, and Fairy Fire to handle invisible creatures. Honestly, Light Clerics might get the best extra spells of any cleric subclass. You're just a walking flamethrower. At level 1, your ability Warding Flare lets you impose disadvantage on an attack roll coming in from a creature within 30 feet a few times a day. That can come in clutch when you're holding concentration on a really important spell and do not want to get hit. And from 6th level, you can even protect your allies with it too. At 2nd level, your Channel Divinity lets you banish any magical darkness, which is situationally useful, and also deal 2d10 plus your cleric level damage to any nearby creatures. That scales nicely through the game. Great for one-shotting a load of goons if they're all piling up on you. But the real juice comes at 8th level. Potent Spellcasting lets you add your wisdom modifier to any damage dealt with a cantrip. Sadly, the cantrip has to be a cleric one, so you can't multiclass into warlock and break the game with Eldritch Blast. But still, an extra 5 damage on every cantrip is big. Toll the Dead is already the highest damaging cantrip in a vacuum, and this nearly doubles its power. Finally, at level 17, you get the unfortunately named Corona of Light ability. This turns you into a human light bulb, shedding bright light at 60 feet and dim light for a further 30. Any enemies in that bright light have disadvantage on saving throws against your fire spells, which is basically a long way of saying motherfucking super fireball. All in, light clerics make amazing spell slingers wrapped up in medium armor. You're basically a wizard who can heal and can tank and can commit holy arson. Beautiful.
Welcome back to D&D Therapy. Have the nightmares stopped?
No.
They're getting worse. What did you see?
I saw death. Monsters.
And a lot of dick jokes. We make a lot of dick jokes at my table.
And then what happened?
We were slaughtered and then brought back to fight again. Over and over. That must have been very bad. 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 It was fucking awesome!
Steinhardt's Guide to the Eldritch Hunt is a brutal expansion to D&D, introducing Eldritch horror and Soulsborne inspirations for an incredible, nightmarish setting. With a new madness system and dozens of new races, subclasses, weapons, and monsters, it is the ultimate terror to unleash on your game nights. It even introduces an ever-shifting cycle of 8 Eldritch moons that completely change the face of the world, transforming even peaceful creatures into bloodthirsty beasts during the eclipse. Support on Kickstarter today to get a ton of amazing rewards and embrace the darkness of the Eldritch Hunt. Link in description. Phantom Rogue. Phantom Rogues are the perfect blend of flavor and power, and they're all about death. At level 3, you get Whispers of the Dead, netting you a bonus skill or tool proficiency after a long rest when a ghost shares its knowledge with you. Also at level 3, you get Wails from the Grave. Now, when you slap someone with a sneak attack, you get to slap someone else up to 30 feet away with half that sneak attack damage as well. This is wicked. Rogues are great at single-target assassination in D&D, but tend to struggle against numerous enemies. Wails from the Grave helps that a lot, and you can use it a number of times per long rest, equal to your proficiency modifier. At 9th level, you go full Dementor, stealing the souls of people who die nearby. As a reaction, you can nab a fleeting soul and make it into a soul trinket. You can have a number of these bad boys equal to your proficiency bonus at any one time, and they do things. While you have one, you get advantage on every death saving throw and constitution saving throw. Also, when you sneak attack someone, you can shatter a soul trinket to get a free use of Wails from the Grave. Also, you can destroy a soul trinket to ask the spirit inside a single question. They don't have to be truthful, but it's still a flavorful way to get information. At level 13, you go full Kitty Pryde and can phase through objects. As a bonus action, you can go spectral, gain a 10-foot fly speed, hover. All attack rolls coming in at you have disadvantage, and you can move through creatures and objects as if they were difficult terrain. You do take 1d10 force damage if you end your turn inside an object, but you aren't pushed out or anything. So you can hide in the ground and just eat the 1d10 force damage each turn, popping out to stab someone in the back and then vanishing underground again. It lasts for 10 minutes, and you can do it once per long rest for free. However, you can do it additional times by simply shattering a soul trinket. Finally, at level 17, you get the death knell. Now, whenever you use your Wails from the Grave feature, you deal the bonus damage to both creatures, not just the second one. That basically doubles the power of your sneak attacks, 20d6, spread across two creatures. Also, you get a free soul trinket anytime you finish a long rest with that one, so you're always ready to go. All in, Phantom Rogues deal big damage, have cool abilities, and can handle groups of enemies better than any other type of rogue. Badass. Horizon Walker Ranger. Horizon Walkers are all about fighting extra-planar threats. Starting at 3rd level, you can magically sense the presence of any planar portal within 1 mile once per day. Evil cultists trying to summon Orcus? Boom! You know exactly where they are. You also get the Planar Warrior ability. As a bonus action, you can point to a creature within 30 feet, shout fuck you, and the next time you deal damage to them this turn, they take an additional 1d8 force damage. That increases to 2d8 at level 11, and the ability also makes all the damage you deal with that attack force, which is probably the best damage type in the game. But we gotta talk about your incredible additional spells. Protection from Evil and Good is a fantastic buff when fighting creatures native to other planes. And Misty Step is obviously amazing. Haste is a powerful and fun buff effect, and Banishment is just insane. In fact, it's more than insane, because if you're doing your job as a Horizon Walker correctly, you'll be fighting creatures native to other planes. That makes Banishment a one-hit kill, because they just don't come back. The last spell you get is Teleportation Circle, which is a handy utility spell and makes total sense with the Horizon Walker flavor. At level 7, you can cast the 7th level spell Etherealness completely for free as a bonus action, but it ends at the end of this turn. It's a complicated spell, but basically you become a ghost, able to fly up and down and move through objects and people. It's great for escaping restraints or sneaking through locked doors and thick walls. But the most iconic feature comes at level 11. You can teleport in combat. Whenever you take the attack action, you can teleport up to 10 feet before the attack. That's already badass, but you also get an extra attack every turn if you can hit three creatures with this. I always think of Spider-Man portaling around beating down Thanos when I imagine this ability. It's just frickin' cool. Finally, at 15th level, you get Spectral Defense, which is kind of like the Rogue's Evasion ability, but you get it 10 levels later than they do. You can use a reaction to give yourself resistance to all the damage you would take from one attack. You're now very hard to kill, as well as being impossible to pin down and deal great damage. But most importantly, Horizon Walkers are badass for any narrative. Your whole thing is seeking out portals to other planes and guarding against multiversal threats. There's so much that can be done here, traveling between the nine hells and the abyss, fighting devils and demons, and being a badass legendary warrior of vengeance. Shadow Sorcerer. Shadow Sorcerers are low-key incredible. From level 1, you have 120 feet of dark vision, and anytime you take damage that will reduce you to 0 hit points, you can make a con save to fall to 1 hit point instead. You can only do it once per long rest, but damn, you are hard to kill. From 3rd level, you also get the Darkness spell for free, and you can cast it with 2 sorcery points instead of a spell slot. When you cast it in this way, you can see through it, which is crazy. One-way heavy obscurement is incredible, giving you advantage on every attack roll and negating a ton of really dangerous spells and abilities. At 6th level, you get the Hound of Ill Omen. For a bonus action and 3 sorcery points, you can summon a pet dog with the Direwolf stat blocks and a few extras. It's a medium-sized monstrosity, it gets temporary hit points equal to half your sorcerer level, and it can move through other creatures and objects. When it's summoned, you give it a target of another creature within 120 feet. The Hound always knows where that target is, and must use its action to sprint towards them and attack. So far, this is all pretty cute, but here's the busted part. While your Devil Doggo is within 5 feet of the target creature, they have disadvantage on all saving throws against your spell. Boom! That is insane. Just bonus action summon this boy next to your targets and then hit them with a devastating suck or save effect, like Polymorph or Dominate Person. Plus, you get extra damage every round from the psychotic Bloodhound you just sicked on him. Amazing. At 12th level, you get the ability to bonus action teleport 120 feet from a point of dim light or darkness to another point of dim light or darkness. Simple, but powerful, and you can do it as often as you'd like. Finally, at 18th level, you get Umbral Form. Bonus action, 6 sorcery points, you get weird. You resist all damage except for force and radiant. You can move through objects and creatures, and just like the Phantom Rogue, you take 5 points of force damage if you end your turn inside an object. Interestingly, you only take the damage if you end your turn inside an object, not a creature, so you could theoretically hang out inside your enemies free of charge. Terrifying. You could throw out a brutal concentration spell like Sickening Radiance and just hang out inside a bookshelf while everyone else in the room dies. All in, Shadow Sorcerers are fantastic, really hard to kill for a spellcaster, and all of their abilities are top tier. Plus, any subclass that comes with a pet is instantly S tier, obviously. But while we're chatting about awesome subclasses, what about the Calamity Barbarian? A walking natural disaster, channeling the primal forces of elemental chaos with their disaster strikes. You can get that subclass on Patreon, along with hundreds of pages of maps, adventures, races, and other subclasses by clicking up here or down there. You can also watch Patreon exclusive videos too, and vote on what classes and subclasses appear in these videos. Remember to like and subscribe, check out other videos on the channel, and I'll see you next time.